Thank you, Matthew. Good morning, board.
Good morning.
Nice to be with you. I have a slide presentation that I'll share. If you get that up. And I will be taking off my mask for the purposes of clarity for the public. I'll be offering an update on COVID-19 as well as monkeypox today, starting with an overview of our current situation in terms of the numbers, and then get into some of the key strategies in both of those communicable disease threats that we're facing as a community. When the slides come up, you'll see that we have, right now we are in the longest prolonged period of high transmission rates as a county since the start of the pandemic. We've had approximately 80 to 100 new cases per day now, at least since over 2 months. If you look at our epidemic curve, you'll see that there's a rapid rise and a fall in these very discernible waves. We're now in sort of a high plateau period that is now being fueled by the BA5 variant of Omicron. As of 2 weeks ago, that is now the dominant variant in Marin County, making up right now probably 90 to 100% of the cases, because 2 weeks ago, it was about 85% of all cases. And I'll just continue to, there we go. Can I have a next slide, please? So these are I'll start with the sort of the take homes and then offer more information in each of these that we're seeing, as I said, sustained high rates of transmission. BA5 is the variant that is dominant. Our hospitalization rates remain stable. Our vaccines remain protective. Masks are recommended indoors, and we're monitoring the situation closely. Next slide, please. So this is the epidemic curve I was referring to, and you can see while there's a sort of a gradual decline in cases, it is still a high level of transmission for over 2 month period. Next slide, please. What's important about looking at case rates now is that we recognize that we are increasingly under reporting cases. And the way we know that is by looking at our wastewater. And this solid blue line shows the average of our wastewater concentrations of the virus across our four different areas where we're collecting wastewater for looking at virus levels in Marin County. And it shows that our rates are very similar now to where they were at that the peak of the Omicron 1 surge. So we're looking back to January, remembering such high case rates we had there. We're seeing similar amounts of virus in our wastewater, although we're only seeing about one third the number of cases now as we had then, which is a sign that with increased home testing and less reporting of positive results, despite the fact that we are still seeing high rates of case rates, it's actually an under reporting, which is both bad news and good news. Obviously, it reduces our window and our access to the information and our surveillance capacity when we see under reporting. But what that actually means is, if you think about it, if our hospitalization rates are stable and we're actually seeing less reporting, it means that the risk of anyone who's being infected to be hospitalized is actually decreasing over time. Next slide, please. This is our ongoing surveillance for variants. And you can see here on the far right, those orange and the red represent BA4 and BA5, and they make up 90% of our variants in Marin County now. And this is typical of what's happening around the region and in fact, the nation. Next slide, please. And these are our hospitalization rates. You can see we have separated out in the light blue versus dark blue, the number of people who are in the hospital for COVID-19, that is, they've been admitted because they are sick with COVID-19 infection, versus those that are in the hospital and have incidentally been detected to have COVID-19, someone who comes in with a broken leg or it's time to deliver their baby. And because everyone who's hospitalized gets tested, we find some fraction of those individuals, because the rate of transmission is so high in the community, lo and behold, that they are infected with COVID-19, but it's not contributing to any serious illness for them. And that's an important distinction for us ongoing. Next slide, please. And this is just another way of capturing how our hospitalization rates have been relatively stable at around 10 people for COVID-19 in the hospital in Marin County for about 2 months. So we really haven't seen an appreciable change in the risk of hospitalizations, coinciding with that also high rate of community prevalence. Next slide, please. And then this, we look at cases, we look at hospitalizations and deaths, and this is looking at our deaths. And what you see here is since the beginning of the pandemic, about 256 deaths in Marin County residents. 70% of those deaths occurred prior to the wide availability of vaccines. So that's on the far left there. You can see those first two waves coincided with kind of the pre-vaccine waves of COVID. And then on the right, you see post-vaccination. And we're seeing about one death now per week. And that coincides again with high rates of transmission, but it's much lower mortality rate than we were seeing earlier in the pandemic. Again, 70% of our deaths occurred within that first year of our pandemic experience, and now we're 2.5 years in. Next slide, please. So just looking back of 2020 versus 2022, when President Biden was diagnosed with COVID-19, and now the assessment that he's well and he's going to be okay, it reminded me of to sort of look back to remember what our experience was in 2020. The odds of dying of COVID-19 in a Marin County resident above age 65 in 2020 was 1 in 10. If you're above age 75, President 79, if you're above age 75, your odds of dying of COVID-19 in Marin County in 2020 was 1 in 7. 15% of our residents above age 75 who were infected in 2020 died, which is one of the reasons why I think we all carry a form of trauma actually from that experience as a community where so many of our residents were passing, and the consequences of being infected when you were an older resident in particular were so much more severe. Now in 2022, less than 1 out of 100 individuals above age 65 when they're infected are passing from COVID-19. Next slide, please. So why has case severity and mortality decreased? The first is immunity from vaccination. The second is immunity from surviving past infection. Both of those forms of immunity are very important in terms of protecting us. The third is treatments. We have earlier detection with home testing, so people are able to get diagnosed earlier in the context of their own lives without having to wait to go into a healthcare provider to get the PCR test. And then they're able to get access to better both outpatient and inpatient therapies. So the ability to take care of people who are very sick in the hospitals have improved. We also have now Paxlovid and more outpatient therapy. And then there's less virulence. So the strains themselves have changed. There's changes in the virus. There's also changes in the human population. Next slide, please. And this is one of, I think, the most stark illustrations of the benefit of vaccinations. These are case rates that were happening in our long-term care facilities. About 65% of deaths in Marin County have been among residents of long-term care facilities since the start of the pandemic. So this was obvious a key strategy for us when the vaccines first arrived was to get out into those facilities and vaccinate residents. This is going back to December of 2020 when the first vaccines arrived. We went and offered first doses, then we were able to go to do second doses. That's really when the immunologic benefit kicks in. And you can see a very dramatic decrease in case rates in our long-term care facilities. And that really was the primary contributor to that dramatic reduction in mortality in Marin that has been sustained. Next slide, please. So second boosters, this is an important priority moving forward. As I said, this is one of the key strategies that is going to get us through the rest of the summer with BA5, is making sure that everyone who's above age 50 and is eligible goes ahead and get that second booster. We've added this to our dashboard. That orange bar there is the number of Marin County residents who have received now their second booster dose. It's almost 60,000. And those are people largely age 50 or above. About 45% of our residents age 50 to 65 have received the second boosters, and 65% of our residents age 65 and over have received their second booster. We want to do better than that. Next slide, please. So second boosters are recommended for all residents above age 50. We have had no deaths among any residents who have received that second booster. It is highly protective, both against infection, but actually more importantly against severe illness and death in the short term. So the immunity from that, we know BA5 is much better at evading the immune system. However, when you get the vaccine, you're well protected for 60 to 90 days easily with that second booster dose. You don't need to wait till the fall vaccine. In fact, we were recommending people who are age 50 or older not wait for that fall vaccine. While we are anticipating a better vaccine in the fall that might be better matched to Omicron, one of the questions we frequently get is, should I just wait in that case? And the recommendation has shifted to no because of the increased infectivity and immune evasiveness of BA5. Next slide, please. Shifting to pediatric vaccines, as you know, our 0 to 5-year-olds were made eligible for vaccines not too long ago. We have about 24%, about 1 in 4 of our families of children 0 to 4 have chosen to get the vaccine. three or four have chosen to wait. And we are offering a recommendation that people have that conversation with their pediatrician to navigate the choices that they face around pediatric vaccines. For context, I've offered here in the dotted yellow line, the national rates of vaccination within that first month that our pediatric vaccines were available, about 3% across the nation were vaccinated. In Marin County, it's about 24%. And then comparing that to the 5 to 11-year-olds nationally, about 18% of children age 5 to 11 were vaccinated within the first month of eligibility. In Marin, that was about 60%. So, you know, showing just the dramatic increased uptake of vaccines in Marin relative to national averages, which has been one of our greatest assets as a county in getting us through this pandemic since the start. Next slide, please. To face covering, you know, there's obviously one of the most divisive and politicized elements of a response. I just want to, you know, have a chance to sort of step back and offer the basics, which is that a high quality mask does protect you from being infected. This is what healthcare workers have been doing for years. You know, as a physician, while I was working in hospitals, you have someone that might be infectious. You put on a mask, you walk into the room, you can have that interaction with them. A high quality mask that actually prevents you from breathing in the virus will protect you from being infected. It's not complicated. So carry a mask with you and use your judgment. We are not planning to impose a mask mandate. We think that at this point in the pandemic, people have learned enough about what their individual risk profile is. They've learned how to read the room. They recognize that when there's large numbers of people gathered together indoors, that there's a risk of transmission. They know how that a mask will protect them. And we are strongly recommending that people make that choice to cover their face in indoor public settings to prevent being infected. Just to offer information, I sort of see my role now as being just offering the best possible information for people to navigate the choices that are theirs to make, both in vaccines and in masks. And I think one important fact is that with the estimated prevalence right now in the community of about 5%, so 1 in 20 being infected, you can just do some statistics to say, well, if there's 10 people in a room, what is the likelihood that at least one person is infected? If there's 25 people in a room, what's the likelihood that at least one person is infected? You get up to 50 people in a room together, imagine a grocery store as an example, there's a 92% likelihood that at least one person in that setting is infected. So the likelihood of exposure is relatively high in Marin because of the high baseline prevalence. That baseline prevalence is estimated based on hospitalization rates and the fact that we're testing every single person that comes into the hospital. So we get an estimate of asymptomatic carriage. Next slide, please. So here's the upgrade your mask. So we're recommending that people move, you know, the surgical mask is somewhat protective. Those KN95s or KF94 masks or the N95 masks, these are the ones that actually are more form a seal around your mouth. And those are the ones that doctors and nurses use to protect themselves from being infected. They're widely available on the market. Pharmacies, there's a federal program. Now you can actually go into a pharmacy and get them for free. We're also distributing those sorts of masks through our community response teams to make sure our low-income residents have access to high-quality masks. Next slide, please. Shifting to monkeypox. Monkeypox is now a global, I would call it a pandemic. I expect that designation will be rendered relatively soon because it meets the criteria. It's all across the world now. It was previously limited to Central Africa. It is an epidemic in most nations now. It differs from COVID-19 in some important ways, just to set the stage. It's mainly transmitted through intimate contact, skin to skin contact. You know, COVID-19 is obviously transmitted through the air. So it is currently overwhelmingly in a subset of our population, which is men who have sex with men through skin-to-skin contact, currently mostly sexual contact. Much lower risk of hospitalization or death, and no deaths of any people with monkeypox in the United States since the start of the epidemic here in the US. There's been, I think, one hospitalization now in the state of California. When people are hospitalized, it's mainly for palliation because of the painfulness of the condition. And we are working to, the other difference is that this permanent protection when you're vaccinated or whether you've been infected, you actually have permanent immunity compared to COVID-19, which we know because the virus evolves so quickly, our immunity is waning over time. We can be reinfected over and over again. Next slide, please. This is the numbers in the state of California. There's about 21 counties that have had some cases of monkeypox. San Francisco has the highest number of cases at about 160. In Marin there, you can see us with our two cases. We've had two confirmed cases of monkeypox in Marin and one suspect case. Next slide, please. So I said two confirmed, one suspect. Actions taken by Marin County Public Health so far is that we've done contact investigations of our known cases to make sure that those that they had contact with are offered that post, what we call post-exposure prophylaxis, which is the form of a vaccine to make sure that they don't get sick. We're also issued public health advisories to our healthcare providers. This is one of the challenges that's reminiscent of the early days with COVID, which is these, as a new infectious disease, our healthcare community needs to learn about it so they can actually look, you know, early diagnosis and treatment. So that's part of our role in public health is to make sure the healthcare system is prepared to respond. We've done education and outreach to our at-risk residents. That is mainly men who have sex with men. So our community-based partners like SPAR Center, who really serve that community, have been valuable assets and partners so far. We are distributing vaccine to our healthcare providers. We've gotten a total as a county of 150 doses, which is not nearly enough. Obviously the vaccines are a scarce supply and the federal government is working to increase supply and get them out to states, and then states distribute them to local jurisdictions. We are advocating to get more doses. And then we are making sure that our residents have access to healthcare and vaccine and treatment. Next slide, please. So what is monkeypox? You know, this is just some of the information that we're distributing. It's a viral infection transmitted through close contact. As I said, the symptoms are rashes. It's a rash that is it's pox. So poxes are small red lesions across the skin. Compared to if you Google monkeypox, you would find kind of the historical presentation of it, which was a full body rash, often on the face. The current circulating strains are much more limited. The rash seems to be limited to the genitals, penis and perianal area primarily. And that's something that's important for people to be aware of. And you know, if they're having any rash, especially if they're sexually active, to refrain from sexual activity until they have that rash evaluated. People also experience constitutional symptoms, fever, headaches, muscle aches, and swollen lymph nodes. Importantly, the symptoms can last for a long time, so up to a month. And anytime during that month period, you can actually transmit the virus to others. So one of the recommendations is that people who have those rashes, you know, get it evaluated, but there may be a period of up to a month where limiting sexual contact is an important way to prevent spread. Next slide, please. And you know, what we're recommending to our community is this is obviously a dynamic environment. I think there's been a lot of concern and fear in the gay community, and we want to make sure that people stay informed, that they maintain contact with their healthcare provider if there's any concerns or questions or any rash develops. And then again, if there is a rash, to take a break and refrain from sexual activity and make sure you're getting the care that you deserve. Next slide, please. So in summary, for COVID-19, we're seeing sustained high rates of transmission fueled by BA5. Boosters and masks are our best tools currently. With monkeypox, it's a new infectious disease threat. We're supporting at-risk communities through prevention, vaccination, and treatment, and we're monitoring the situation closely. And we'll be getting vaccines out as soon as we get more available. We'll be hosting vaccination events with partners like the SPAR Center and Kaiser and Marin Community Clinics. That concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Willis. I appreciate the comprehensive update. Good to see you again. Live. Obviously, the message is clear. Deaths are down from the days we all remember. Hospitalizations. Yet, from what I'm hearing, at least anecdotally in the community, I mean, a lot of people are getting it. And they're showing significant symptoms. In other words, this is not just invariably a mild situation that we can just start looking beyond, but it's knocking folks on their proverbial rear ends when they get it. There's also apparently a course of treatment that they're given automatically. I'm forgetting what that medication is called. I'm wondering if you can talk about that as well, but just It sounds like it's stopping short of then having to be hospitalized, but yet it's still serious. But if you can kind of elaborate on that.
Yeah, great question. Paxlovid is the oral medication that is now widely available and is definitely one of the main contributors to the mortality reduction. We are now able to, when anyone is diagnosed with COVID-19, especially if they're having symptoms, reach out to their healthcare provider. It says, I think one of the key messages for all of us as a community is if you are diagnosed with COVID-19, especially if you're above age 50, or if you have any medical conditions that make you at higher risk for ending up in the hospital, to reach out to your medical provider, and that provider can just write a prescription, and you can go to a pharmacy, any pharmacy in Marin County, and go ahead and pick up oral Paxlovid. It's a 5-day course, and it very effectively reduces the risk of hospitalization, 89% reduction in risk for people who would otherwise end up in the hospital. And then you're right, it is not benign. I don't mean to say that this is behind, over, but I think the reality is that this is still remains highly disruptive to us as a society, as a community, because we're seeing a lot high rates of infection. People do get sick, it's like a flu. I have more in my own life. I have more people that I know infected now than at any point since the start of the pandemic. And many are saying, I thought this was going to be just like a cold. I feel terrible. So it's definitely worth taking the steps to prevent infection that I outlined here by covering your face and getting that second booster.
Great. Thanks.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Willis. Very thorough update. Getting back to the Paxlovid, can you talk a little bit about the availability of that for our low-income communities who might not have health insurance, and how do they access that drug?
Yeah. So in Marin, we have a network of healthcare providers or clinics called federally qualified health centers, meaning the federal government actually subsidizes them to provide healthcare for people that don't have insurance or have limited insurance like Medi-Cal. That's really our safety net system. And that's, you're fortunate to have really excellent healthcare providers, great doctors, great nurses, in a variety of different locations across the county, geographically distributed. And throughout the pandemic, that's really been our main asset for making sure that no one's falling through the cracks despite income or insurance status. So all of our federal qualified health centers do have access to Paxlovid. So, and most of our low-income residents, we hope at this point, because it's been one of our care messages for years, is to establish a relationship with the healthcare provider in a community clinic. They can get them there. If someone still doesn't have a connection with the community clinic, they can go to our OptumServe testing site, which is located in the canal. And if they test positive, there's Paxlovid actually made available to them for free right then and there. They can walk out of that visit with Paxlovid, walk in, get a diagnosis in 15 minutes, and walk out of there with the medication without any cost.
Great, terrific. And then related to any adverse data for Marin, do we know any more than we knew the last time you were here related to vaccinations, and or will we know more in the future? Or when do you expect some of that data to become available?
Yeah, we've had about 250,000 of our residents now have gotten vaccinated. So we have a lot of, experience collectively of the vaccine. And one of the reasons I think we've had some of the highest vaccination rates is that we all have now as a community sort of a lived experience of it's a positive feedback as far as, people are getting vaccinated, doing well with the vaccine, and actually being protected from the vaccine, observing lower hospitalization rates, observing lower death rates as a consequence of high vaccination rates. We do have close relationships with all of our healthcare providers who can reach out to us if there's any adverse reactions. We also have VAERS, it was mentioned by one of the callers earlier. VAERS is an intentionally oversensitive surveillance system. Anyone for any adverse effect, whether or not it's connected to the vaccine or not, people who are asked to report into VAERS are not being asked, can you verify that this adverse event was related to the vaccine? All they need to say is someone got a vaccine and then this happened in their life, right? So we don't know causality. The benefit of that is that the CDC can then look and see, wow, there's a lot of people, like for example, the myocarditis risk was actually elevated through that system, which had not been actually surfaced in the clinical trial. So it was in the real world experience of making the vaccine available to millions of people that through VAERS, we're able to actually see that relationship between what seemed like an unusual number of people having, heart pain and a temporal relationship when they got the vaccine. And that's where we were actually able to learn that there is in fact a very small risk, but real risk associated with myocarditis for the vaccine, especially among young men. That's an example of the effectiveness and the sensitivity of the surveillance systems we have. And those have not found, I mean, the blood clots with the Janssen was another example, but that's what I lean into because the numbers there are robust enough to really tell rare events when they occur because you're looking at millions of vaccine doses compared to what we would see in the county. We're not seeing any evidence of adverse reactions in Marin County, but I wouldn't want to sort of see that as sufficient evidence of complete safety. I really want to see a more robust database, and that's why we look to the CDC. The last thing I'll say about that is we do track all cause mortality, and it's something we've been tracking from the start, and it's on our dashboard. And basically, we're looking at just how many people die in Marin County. We have about 2,000 deaths a year in Marin, has that increased or decreased? And we have not seen a change. I think it's one of the most remarkable success points for us as a county. There has not been a real change in mortality in Marin County through the pandemic. And that is very unusual. Most counties, across the nation have seen an appreciable increase in just death overall because of the pandemic. Life expectancy in African Americans across the nation has been foreshortened by about 2 years because of COVID-19. In Marin County, we don't see any change. So we're not seeing, if we look across, in 10, 20 years from now, people look across at our mortality rates, they're not going to see a signal of COVID-19. Because of the vaccine, because of the success of this county in reducing transmission rates and the vaccine, the effectiveness of the vaccine. But correspondingly, we would also see potentially an increase. So I think one of the callers mentioned that they think it may be actually fueling increased mortality with 250,000, almost all of us being vaccinated. We're not seeing any increase either.
Thank you, Dr. Willis.
Nice to see you, doctor.
Good to see you.
I've been hearing about a third vaccine. And I'm wondering, could you talk about that for a minute and what you think?
Okay. Yeah. So it's a fourth. We have the Janssen, which is kind of less, we're not recommending. There are some areas where they use the Janssen mm-hmm. vaccine. Right. There's Moderna, Pfizer, which are kind of the dominant ones. Mm-hmm. And now Novavax is the new one coming on the scene. It is a protein vaccine, so it's more a conventional formulation. It's not an mRNA vaccine. It's more like the vaccine we use for pertussis or meningitis. Mm. What it does is it offers the immune system just a piece of the virus. It's not live in any way. It's just a piece of the virus so that it can actually see that and make antibodies against that. So when you're exposed to the actual virus in the future, after you've been vaccinated, you already have antibodies that are able to recognize that because you've been offered sort of a mimic in the form of a protein. We think that's going to be effective for some of our community members who have been resistant to the mRNA vaccine. Mm-hmm. The only people eligible for that vaccine in Marin right now are adults, above 18 who have not been vaccinated. It's not a booster.
Okay.
And so fortunately, I think in Marin, that's a relatively small group of, if you also say these are people who would be interested in getting vaccinated who have not yet so far, but it's an important addition to our array of vaccines.
Okay. Thank you.
And we'll be having that available in about 2 to 3 weeks.
Okay.
We've ordered 500 doses.
Wow. Okay.
All right, Dr. Willis, two questions for me. One, with regards to school starting up next month in August, right? Yeah, school startup. You interact with the schools and MCOE. So what are sort of the general plans in terms of how they're going to approach COVID going into the new school year?
Yeah, the schools have been, excellent partners all the way along. I think it's been sort of the strongest linkages is between public health and Marin County Office of Education and the schools, kind of getting schools open early and keeping them open. We're going to just continue to that infrastructure. So we have public health liaisons at every school that we're going to stay engaged with as school starts. I think the real question in my mind is BA5. What is BA5? How is the behavior of BA5 going to inform our strategies in schools? I think testing is going to be an important tool for us to keep schools open. We're making sure that they have ample testing available, making sure that, kids, if they're symptomatic, they're able to test and they stay home if they're infected. The question of masking in schools has not been answered yet. We don't intend to impose a mask mandate in schools. But we also want to make sure that people recognize that masks are protective and as a personal choice. And we'll be, you know, we have a community-wide forum scheduled for August 8th, coming into the school year, and we're working with MCOE to make sure the messages are clear for everyone.
Right, Damien, you have a follow-up to that?
Yeah, Dr. Willis, going back to the question of how do folks kind of get in line for treatment? We are hearing that it's hard to get treatment through healthcare providers. So do you recommend going to the testing sites, or like what's the best way for folks to do that?
Yeah, if anyone's having trouble getting treatment from a healthcare provider, first of all, I'd like to know who that healthcare provider is, because I think our goal is to make sure that all of our healthcare providers recognize the benefit of treatment and are able to offer it. And I think that was a more common story, 2 months ago, 1 month ago. But yes, the LHI site, and it's on our website. If people go to coronavirus.marinhhs.org, our coronavirus website, there's a treatment tab, and they can find where people can actually go to the LHI site. That's the one I mentioned to Supervisor Redoni, where anyone can just walk in free of charge, positive test. They can actually get treatment offered right then and there.
Okay.
That's in the canal.
And then one last question on monkeypox. So as I'm assuming that the vaccine availability will slowly increase, hopefully. In the meantime, how are we approaching sort of distribution of that vaccine? And then secondly, related to monkeypox, for individuals who may not have a connection to or an association with SPAR or whatever, is the county putting up information with regards to monkeypox on our website, or is there a place for folks to go for more information if they don't necessarily have an affiliation otherwise?
Yes, absolutely. So we do have, we've established a monkeypox website on our county website. And it's dedicated to both clinicians who are looking for information about the latest testing guidance and treatment guidance, but also for the public as a whole. California Department of Public Health also has excellent material around just education information as the situation evolves. Obviously, this is evolving quickly. One of the most important changes over the last week has been the availability of treatment, TPOXX treatment. So we're actually working. I didn't talk too much about that. We're actually potentially actually going to be able to start treating cases as early as next week in Marin County. Most of our, if you're not connected to SPAR, most of our healthcare providers, like Kaiser, is one of our key partners. We distributed 60 doses to Kaiser, and they're actually offering them to their highest risk patients. We're going to get more doses to Kaiser. So through that distribution network of healthcare providers, most of our residents should have access to the best information through that provider, as well as access to vaccines. But for those that don't, I think we would, refer them to the website and welcome them to, tie into to care in one of our federally qualified health centers.
Great. Okay. Thank you.
Go ahead. Could you just slowly say what the county's website is? Because I think it's important that we keep saying that for people.
Yeah. It's marinhhs.org.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the monkeypox page.
Okay.
And I don't know the actual URL for the monkeypox page per se, but it's available by a tab on our main website.
Okay, thank you.
Or probably Google Marin County HHS monkeypox. Same with the coronavirus, which and that website continues to be updated as well with all the coronavirus information. All right, thank you, Dr. Willis.